Hi, everybody, and welcome to Paul Lisnick Behind the Curtain, a chance for me to step away from the worlds of politics and law you watch me cover every day on television into our radio world of theater, the arts, and today, comedy. Actually, theater and comedy, those two things go together. I am talking to really just a legendary comedian named Judy Gold, who you likely know, and you are going to get to see her here in Chicago November 8th. 9th and 10th. We'll talk about that. But for now, Judy, you are so nice to spend some time. From what I understand, you are in the Middle East. You are trying to resolve things there.
Yes, I am here in Tel Aviv, and I'm meeting with all the leaders. They haven't shown up yet, but I hear people are very late in the Middle East. They don't.
You were on time for the interview, so that's the main thing. But
yeah,
right.
But yes, I'm here. It's just beautiful, and the food is phenomenal, and it's also very sad. But
No, I was gonna shift the gear because I was gonna say the last time I was there was at the King David Hotel, and they have this beautiful globe
that thing. Brunch buffet. First of all,
I was going to the artwork.
I'm at the Carlton Hotel, which is on the beach. The breakfast. I don't think people have all, various opinions about Israel. The food, everyone will agree, the food here is beyond the produce, that lebna, that yogurt sauce and the shawarma and the schnitzel. And I have been eating but it's healthy. It's good for you. So, yeah.
I have one issue. The milk was warm.
They don't know. With the ice, they're not good with the ice here.
No,
and the I like my drinks cold. My water, my milk. Yeah, no, they're not big on that. And you have to ask for water, and they I heard that it's only in the United States that the ice is a plenty.
That actually is true. I have cousins in England, and I went there for dinner once, and they brought out, I said, oh, can I have some ice in this very warm Coke that you put on the,
right.
And they brought out this little tray. It was like this, like, oh, we have 4 cubes. How many do you, of
right.
those do you need? I'm like, I need 12 cubes. What the?
Right. I need the entire glass filled with ice, and then I pour my drink in. That's how
yes.
it goes.
With the can, so I can refill it as necessary.
Exactly.
So that is the New Jersey, New York part of you, not so much the world traveler part of you.
Right. I mean, you do get used to things when you travel. I'm not a great traveler. I overpack. I get very frustrated with, when I can't communicate, because I like to communicate. And I just am so mad at myself for not knowing another language fluently.
I hear you. Now, are you out there?
English.
I know you're relaxing a bit, but you're performing as well?
No, I'm not relaxing. No. Yes, we're doing shows. We did one in Jerusalem, and then we did Herzliya, and tonight is Tel Aviv. And we're doing this for an organization called the Kobe Mandel Foundation. And it is a camp for people with PTSD, most kids, mostly with PTSD, and bereaving mothers. And they're so overloaded with people. And Kobe Mandel was a 12-year-old boy who went hiking. This is years ago, when hiking with his friend. They cut school for the first time, and he was stoned to death, and they found him in a cave. I thought this would be an uplifting story for your show. And anyway, he was a big comedy fan. And so they started this camp, and they raised money by doing these comedy shows. We've done 3 big theaters. They do smaller venues as well, and they do a lot of fundraising in the United States, but it's really an incredible organization.
Wow, that is fantastic. And mm-hmm. is it they do it worldwide, or they do it some in the United States? I've not heard of the organization.
Oh yeah. The Kobe Mandel Foundation, the camp is in Israel.
Okay.
But they raise money all over.
Well, I will check that out and offer some support, because that's important work. Thank you for being a part of that. You're coming to Chicago, of course, and but you are known for so many. I know your career. I mean, we go back to Here Come the Munsters in 1995.
Oh my god!
I wanted to bring up one of your favorite roles.
What?
That one.
That one was so funny because they made a mummy of me. I played
One of the
Edmund Munster's sister, but they made a mummy of me, which was just like me dead, and I was just staring at myself. It was really it freaked me out, even though it was me in all the horrible makeup, but it was freaky, but I had so much fun.
Did you get to keep it?
No, it was like the size of a human being. I think they did something with it in the movie, the film. I don't
Okay.
remember, but
Well, what I
yeah.
love, I just said that to be cute, but I mean, your career is so varied from stand up, and you worked with B.D. Wong, and I love B.D. Wong in your off-Broadway show. Yes, I can say that. But the thing is, and what I know about you is, there are some people who, when you see them in a, I'll call it a stage show, a play, they're thinking, oh, well, we're going to get her comedy, her stand-up act here. That you are very clear about those are two different worlds for you.
100%. I love the theater. I love it. And people say, oh, what's the difference between theater and stand up? I mean, stand up, there's no fourth wall. Stand up, you're in a club. I always say that performing in a theater versus performing in a club, you have to get their attention. And in a theater, you have to keep their attention. They're there to listen. They are a whole different breed. They paid a lot more money to go sit in a theater and be entertained and engaged. In a comedy club, you're dealing with servers and cell phones. I mean, unfortunately, you're dealing with that in theater now, but there's so many things to distract you, so many elephants in the room that you have to acknowledge. And theater is just live theater is it, there is nothing like it. Even, I've been in plays, and I did Shakespeare in the Park. It's beyond because you're doing the same show you did yesterday afternoon and the night before, but it's a new audience. So it is as if you're doing the show for the first time. And it's also sharing the stage with people. I mean, for a comedian, that's why I think a lot of comedians either are fantastic actors or terrible actors, because you have to learn the craft, and the craft is listening, not talking, and it's reacting, not acting, like they call comedy an act. So I feel the two are very different, but as far as having a live audience, I mean, they're well, nothing compares to a live audience. Nothing for me.
By the way, just to be clear, when you come to Chicago, we're getting the stand-up Judy Gold, right?
We're getting stand up, funny, which is it is an art form that I love. It's something I always go back to. It's how I began. And I'm one of the few who loves doing stand up of my generation. I mean, I talk to so many people who became, they started out as stand ups and then they became these huge stars or TV stars. Oh, I don't have to do that anymore. I can't wait to do it. I really love it. And it is an art form. I know a lot of people, they think, oh, it's not an art form. But let me tell you something. It happens to be the only art form where the audience is a huge, if not the most important part of the creative process. So that's why when we have so-called cancel culture or whatever, people turning on you because they didn't like a joke, it's a look. We're just figuring this out. We're trying to find out where the line is. We need you. I often say it's not like, Van Gogh painted half of a, mural and then got a bunch of people out and said, oh, too many sunflowers. What do you think? Or, Leonard Bernstein never, was conducting and looked at the insurance adjuster in the third row and said, too much oboe. That is what we do, and we need you. And so
Never have too much
often
oboe, by the way. I just need to say that.
I love oboe. I love oboe.
Me
But
too.
yes, it is. I just want to give it its credit because people do not think of it as an art form. And so many people think they can do it because they think they can tell a joke.
Yeah, my brother wants to do stand-up. He's convinced he can do stand-up. And I took him to Second City the other night. I went, "You can't do that."
Yeah, it's a lot.
Yeah, because when you have humor that's only funny between you and your brother, then it doesn't play well in front of a larger
Right,
audience.
right. And yes, go ahead.
Well, in terms of, I mean, I assume everybody kind of is going to come, they're going to all know you and stuff, but I just want to talk a little bit of your background because aside from being East Coast girl, which by the way, you have a very Chicago vibe to you. You could
I
live here.
do. I love
You
Chicago.
could
I
live
love
here.
Chicago. I performed there in the late 80s for the first time, and I have loved it ever since. Such a great city.
And maybe because I have a little age on me more so than others, but I know people look at you and they go, "Oh, she's influenced by Joan Rivers," and you are, and some of the great. But I see some of the older stars in you. I was a huge Toadie Fields fan growing
Oh,
up.
I can't. Did you know that she's my favorite? But beyond,
I know she
I,
influenced you. I love
yes.
Toadie before the leg, after the leg. I mean, she was amazing how she kept going.
She never stopped. You watch her, she was fearless. She was fearless. She was a clown, but she was smarter than the audience. And she was hilarious and so authentic. And I seeing her with Jerry Lewis, who was such an anti-female person, especially comics, seeing him sort of halfway insulting her but getting a laugh, and her just giving it right back to him
Exactly.
as his equal. She was so talented, and yeah, what a trooper.
But it's almost as though as you look through time, women, the humor, Phyllis Diller, the sort of self-deprecating, and there is one other one. I know you've talked about some of those, but there's one other one I want to tie in here when you look at the history, because you'll know, because we're not that far from each other in age. But Moms Mabley, I think, has to be
Oh, I
tossed
love
into
Moms
this as
Mabley.
well.
Another example of authenticity to its nth degree. And it's funny. You look at Moms Mabley, she took out, she would take out the teeth and she would talk.
Right.
And yet she was so close to the Kennedys. Her and Jacqueline Kennedy were very close friends. I mean, she was royalty, and yet her character was sort of a washwoman.
That's the point, her character. She was very classy. Do women, do you, I mean, so what my point in bringing all those people up from the past years was that women had a certain road they had to travel, right? I mean, it wasn't that Jerry Lewis and the world of men's comedy. Is it different for you today? I feel like it is. Maybe not. I don't know.
I think it's such a good question because there's a thing I say in one of my shows about Joan Rivers is that when she was in college, someone took her down to the village, Greenwich Village, to see Lenny Bruce, and she said, here was this man who was telling the truth, just the truth, and making it funny. And she said there were no role models there were no women doing that. Women were, vaudevillian. They also sang. You think of, Frances Fay or Sophie Tucker. They were funny, but they also had a cabaret act. And
Right.
you look at the female stand-ups, they had to, you use the term self-deprecating, but it was sort of a disclaimer that they would do in the beginning of their sets to say, "Hey, I know what I am. I know I'm a woman. I should be home ironing my husband's handkerchiefs, but aren't I funny?" And when I was coming up in the 80s and the 90s, we never got to work together. That was the hardest. I think that's what's changed the most, Paul, is that we never ever got to work together. If there was a
Who's the
woman on
we?
the
What do you
show,
mean
there
by we?
the women
Oh,
never
okay.
got to be on the same show together, because if
Okay.
they had a woman, it would be one. And there was a club in Soho called Comedy U Grand on Grand Street, and every Thursday night they had all female comics, and that was the night that we all worked together and bonded. And the system was set up that we're one of you is going to get the job. Who's going to be? And sort of that we would be competitive, but we really all became sisters and very supportive of one another. And now you see multiple women on a show. Also, you know, I came out of the closet on stage in 1996. I go into a club now and I'm trans, I'm non-binary, I'm whatever. No reaction, no negative reaction. You know, it's not like they're saying, I can't listen to you anymore because I know this about you. So it's really changed a lot. And then yet again, it hasn't changed, because if you listen to George Carlin or you listen to Richard Pryor or Joan Rivers, a lot of their material would be just as relevant today as it was 30 years ago.
By the way, off side question, but have you seen Ronnie Marmo's I'm Not a Comedian, I'm Lenny Bruce show?
No, but I heard about it.
Okay.
Is it great?
It's great. He's phenomenal. I can put you in touch with him if you like that. I think
that's awesome.
You'd have
okay.
great appreciation for it. But the other thing that I think makes a comedian so successful is it's about your life. I mean, I know a lot of your stand up and stuff, and it you know, your mother is pretty much my mother, and you know, it's the Jewish component of it and stuff. But you don't hide your personal life; it's out there. And that's what makes all this work. Do you go through life on a daily basis, and when something angers you, whatever, you go, I see funny, I see humor in this.
Oh, always. Always have a notebook, always have a recording device with me. You know, that's the curse of the comic, is that our brains never stop. There's
Did
no
your
break.
mother, would your mother ever say to you, do not you, I don't want to see this in the act?
No, she would more often say, oh, I know this will be in the act tomorrow. I mean, she loved it. She loved it. She never said, don't put that in the act, Judith. But my kids did. My kids, I always asked them first if I could do a joke. My mother, you know, I was like, she was fair game, you know, everything she said.
And when we see you in Chicago, we're going to get a lot of that, of course. We're going to have to get, because that's your personal life. Do you veer into the, will you veer when you're here into the world? I mean, you're coming in here. Actually, it will be just after
Oh,
the
boy.
presidential election.
Yes, I will. Paul,
So
I
we're going to get
will. I
real
do
time
now.
reaction from you.
Oh, how can you ignore that? Absolutely. Current events are a huge part of my act now, because it is what everyone is thinking about. And you sort of have to get it out of the way so that they can relax and laugh and here we go. And, you know, it's funny because at the end of the show, you think, I'm sitting next to someone and I could hate them on paper, but we both laughed at this. And it's definitely a unifier, comedy. It can be a weapon, as we know. Satire is very threatening, especially to aristocratic people and fascist and aristocratic. I meant fascists, really. That might. I mean, I know one.
Right. Autocratic, I
but
think, is what you meant to say.
Huh?
Autocratic is what I think you meant to
Autocratic
say.
is what I meant to say. I'm very
Right.
jet-lagged, but yeah, autocrats and fascists and you know, many leaders try to silence comedians. In other countries, comedians are imprisoned and killed. I mean, it's, you know, comedy is really, we're the truth tellers. And but it's, I just love making people laugh.
Do you
I
find,
love
so
it.
by the way, that means this year, I mean, I'm assuming Chicago is the first place you will, I'm not sure how you could play it's anywhere else. So the election.
Oh,
It's just
that's right. It's right after. That's crazy.
Right. So literally days after. So does that mean you are just writing material just hours before you're going?
Oh, I'll be writing. Oh, of course. Absolutely. I mean, it's going to be the first thing that I, you know, I think
We're
about.
The test audience.
Yes, you're the test audience.
Do you find,
beware.
Right. So my work on air, when I cover politics, I'm an analyst. I'm not a commentator. So I have to be neutral. And
Right.
I do my best. Now, I don't, not necessarily my viewers hear me to be neutral. They
Right.
they complain about everything. But I do
No.
attempt to be neutral.
Yeah.
You have your points of view. I'm sort of curious, when do you expect the people that come to your audience who know you, they're of like mind? Or do you have people who might show up who are like very different mind from you, and then
You
you have
know,
to interact and deal with them?
I do get people who say, I hate your politics, but I've always thought you were funny. And they come. And those are the greatest people, because there's so many comics who I hate their politics and I think they're hilarious. So, but lately, the past 8 years or so, oh, what was that? Wait, what is that? 8 years ago, 2016. What
Yeah.
happened then? Audiences have been, oh, you don't like Trump? I'm out of here. And it's like, I'm a comic. I have an opinion. Every president has been fair game. I mean, we have the White House Correspondents' Dinner, SNL. I mean, we all, that's what we do. We take our leaders to task. And yet, if it was even a benign joke about his hair, people would get, oh, that's it, blah, blah, blah. So that was kind of crazy making, but you
Oh, it's
can't let
interesting.
it control you.
I had a friendship with Jackie Mason actually, for a while because he would come to Chicago and I would take him to his delis. But one of the things I found interesting was he would often say that when he would do his political segments of his humor, because it was more right than left and all that, he
Yes,
goes,
very right.
"People don't
Yeah.
understand. People don't understand. This is who I am. They're just laughing at it." He goes, "But I'm just telling them the truth and how I see
Right,
things." Did we get
truth.
Judy Gold's truth?
100%. 100%. The truth is the only thing that's funny. And the audience can tell if you're not being genuine or if you're lying or, they're there, they want you to succeed. But you got to give the audience credit. They're not dumb. I mean, of course, there are
No,
some,
but by the way, New York,
but
now I'm going to tell you something you don't know. Of course not. New York, Chicago, as you know, many Broadway shows start out, they test their production in Chicago. I won't take this personally, we're pretty smart audiences. We are, I mean,
absolutely
we get it. In New York, you have a lot of tourists, you have a lot of people coming in and out.
right.
But here, you get people who know theater, comedy clubs, the home of Second City. You're going to have a sharp audience, but you know that.
Right, they're sharp, and you know what else? They have this Midwest sensibility, so they're not. I wouldn't say they're not hypercritical, ready to like attack you. It's and it's so much culture in Chicago. Just that's what it is, and there's great schools, and there's so much great art and theater and music. I mean, it's and food. I mean, it's such a great culturally sophisticated town. And I think that makes their audiences even better. Yeah. I
What's
love
on
it
your
there.
when you come to Chicago? Any extra time? Are there certain things that, oh, I'm gonna let's see. The weather will still actually be nice, believe it
It
or
won't be
not.
that bad. I have relatives there, so I'll definitely be seeing my relatives.
Ah, okay.
But oh God, do I walk in that city? I love that place. I love it. And the food and the pizza. I also enjoy the unbelievable pierogies.
Ah, so you go to the Polish neighborhood?
Yes. Oh.
Is that where your rel where do your relatives live?
Well, most of them are dead, but I have a niece and a nephew who just moved there. I don't know where they live.
I grew up in Skokie, which but
Oh,
that
yes. I performed there.
yeah, of
That was
course.
a big ACLU moment there.
Yeah.
I write about that in my book.
Yes, which is what became the show.
Yeah.
By the way, I should ask, are there other projects? Is there another book in the works? What, another show in the works aside from the stand-up? There always has to be something going on with you.
Oh yeah, you have to, because you can't live on your last thing. BD directed that show. We really want to take it on the road. And
Oh, good, good, good.
yeah, I think it's a really important show about, free speech and stand up and not taking yourself so seriously and the dangers of taking yourself too seriously. And then I'm writing another book for a younger audience. And I'm doing a lot of traveling and auditioning and, the usual. I'm
How
getting
much? I
old.
know you and BD have been friends for a very, very long time,
Yeah.
but I'm sort of curious. You are, unlike an actor who just, okay, I've just been cast in Hamlet, whatever. And so the director steps in, or at the Goodman Theater, and the director steps in and guides you. But your show, I mean, are you, did you tell BD to shut up a lot?
No,
Did you let
no.
him say, no, it's okay, y'all walk over here?
Oh, no. We had a script. I wrote it with my friend Eddie Sarfati. We, he was really helped dramaturg the show. And no, I you know, the whole purpose of a director is to, bring this to life. And I want the director to see all the things that I don't see. And so I've always had directors who are so much different than I am. I don't want someone who is, a loud Jewish lesbian from, New Jersey, who grew up in New Jersey. But I want someone with an entire set of eye d different set of eyes and ears and heart, really. And
And who's an
he's
was it
just
important that
a
he too is
he's a
an
genius.
actor? Was it important to you that BD that also that he's
You
an
know what
actor,
it was
not just a
important?
director?
I think it was important that he's also a writer. So I think the most important thing for me was he is so smart. And of all my friends, I've known him since we did All American Girl in 1994, the Margaret Cho
Yeah.
series. He has the most wicked sense of humor. And, you know, there's this truth among comics that we say things to one another that we don't normally say to other people who won't get it or think it'll, oh, it's horrible, don't say that. But we'll call each other, you know, after a tragedy and say, and he thinks like a comic. He has the sense of humor of a comic. And he's brilliant.
Can you share
And
something?
those acting chops to make it theatrical, yes.
That's what, yeah. Well, that's what I
Knows
mean.
what it's like to be an actor on stage.
I sometimes when I'm talking to people who are in plays and stuff, and I'll often ask whether or not their director is the actor's director. And
Right.
sometimes, oftentimes, I mean, because you like people like Joe Mantello. I mean, there's certain people
Yeah.
where you say, yes, that is an actor's director.
Right.
Which is just amazing. See, what, okay, this is the I love all my children question, but stand up, the plays, the books, do you look and say, this is where I most come alive? I don't mean that as a pick your favorite child question.
No, stand-up comedy is where I most come
Really?
alive. Yes. I mean, the
I thought
fact
you
that
might
I
say the state, I thought you might say this, the play version of your work.
no. You know why? I never imagined this when I started at 19 that, you know, I'm going to be 62 in November, and I still get on that subway with my notebook to go down to the Comedy Cellar to try out new material, and it's still just as exciting as it was. I'm less nervous, but to write a bit and be able to try it out on stage to me is just thrilling. I don't know what it is. I
But
love
is
it.
it true? This I had read somewhere, but is it true your career started on a dare
Yes, on a dare in
in
college. A
Rutgers?
Secret Santa, yeah, at Rutgers. And I did my first set in the lounge of our dormitory.
Oh, really? Now that's a good audience, right?
Yeah. Oh,
You
that,
remember what
well,
was your.
who that, no, the people that know you are the worst audience.
Exactly.
Yeah.
What was your, do you remember back then? Like, what was your, when they said, I don't know if it was a tonight we're going to have Judy Gold or whether they said,
Oh,
Judy, get
no,
up
it
and do
was,
something.
no, every night there was, you know, our Secret Santa was people would have to get up in front of everyone and do stuff. And so mine was that you have to do 10 minutes of stand up using all the people on the floor as material.
That's a lot.
And
That's actually a long time for that
oh
situation.
yeah, it was five. It had to be five, because 10, forget it. And so yeah, and I remember I was so nervous and I didn't go to class because I took it so seriously. And I remember standing there and I did my first laugh. I mean, I did my first joke and I got a laugh. And I'm not kidding. It was like an out of body experience as if I was watching myself. And I thought, this is what I'm meant to do.
It's what
This
you
is
were
why
born to
I'm
do.
here. Yeah. And I mean, it's frustrating. There's so much rejection, there's ageism, misogyny, homophobia, whatever. To make people laugh, a crowded room laugh, is the greatest gift, I think.
Did you
I
have family
mean,
support and back in the early days? I mean, did your mother expect you to become a lawyer or something?
they wanted me to be a music teacher. I studied music, and that, you know, they wanted me, but I come from a long line of teachers. But I wanted to perform, and I knew that I wanted to be a performer. But I'm 6'2". I applied for graduate school at Mason Gross School of the Arts, and Bill Esper told me that I was too tall, and he wouldn't be able to cast me. You know, thank God I had done stand up already, because you know, going to those clubs and hanging out and waiting to get on at 2 in the morning and watching these stand ups, that really was my PhD.
This is
And
like
I
a
got to
marvelous
watch the
Mrs.
best of them.
Maisel in real life.
No, she wouldn't. First of all, no one living in that apartment would be a stand-up. Okay. And number two, she
You were
never
ready
would have
for that
gotten
one.
away with that, with the stuff she said at that time. Yeah.
Although you see the Joan Rivers influence in there as well.
Yes. Oh, 100%.
Did you not like that show, or you did like the show?
No, I watched it, but then I realized I was watching it for the apartment.
Decorating. Antique. You like
Yes, I
antiques?
just,
My yes.
yeah. It
You
was,
might like.
you had suspend belief, but you know, I did enjoy that show. Yeah.
Yeah, maybe you have to like my house. I actually, this is sort of we. I, although I built the house in the late 90s, but I've made it look like it's from the 1800s because I love that old antique Gilded
Right.
Age kind of a feel to a place.
Yeah.
And home for you is New York right now, right?
Home is New York and Provincetown, Massachusetts. So
Okay.
I live there about 5 months of the year. And in the summer for 3 months, I do stand up at a, I have a residency at a cabaret. And I love cabaret rooms, by the way. And I write all new material and work on my act all summer. And it's fantastic. And
Well,
then I bring it out on the
Venus
road.
Cabaret, you probably haven't been in the room yet. I can't imagine you have.
No,
Yeah.
I
So it is
haven't.
exactly what you want. It is the cabaret space, bar in the back, intimate, with the front row being pretty close to you. Hopefully, if they
Oh, I
let me
love
in. I'm
it.
one of those kind of front row people, so I like being down
Yeah.
front. And I won't heckle. I'm not that kind of person, but
Oh.
I'm a very encouraging person.
Oh, good, good.
But I just can't wait to see it. And so we should remind people, it's November 8th and 9th. It's an 8 o'clock show.
10th and 10th.
Well, I was going
Oh,
to say that
right.
separate because it's a different
I'm
time.
sorry,
Oh, I'm
Paul.
ready for, no, it's perfectly
Shut
fine.
up, Judy. Okay.
The 8th and 9th at 8 p.m. If on Friday night, by the way, if you happen to be done at 9:15, that's when I do my political week in review on WGN. So go to back to
Oh, I love
WGN,
that.
and it'll
Okay.
give you material, hopefully, when I would see you the next time.
Right.
And then the 10th, you will be there at 5 p.m. That's like the early bird show.
Yeah, that's a little Judy's getting old, and so's
Is
your
it?
audience.
It also gets some maybe some buses pulling up out front, you know, at that
Okay, shut up, Paul. That's not what's going to happen. And you know, people like to watch football on Sunday, so at
That's
least
true.
it's before the football game, maybe.
You are
Yeah.
absolutely right. People can get tickets at Mercury Theater Chicago. I feel like I'm just setting you up for things.
Yeah.
MercuryTheaterChicago.com. MercuryTheaterChicago.com. That'll be on the webpage anyway. People can see that. November 8th, 9th, and 10th. I can't wait to see you in Chicago. And I just hope you have a fabulous time. Let's go to Little
Oh,
Italy
thank
and
you
have
so
pizza.
much. Thank you. And I hope we have a democracy. Anyway, thank you for having me. I love this kind of interviewing, so I really
My
appreciate it.
pleasure, my honor to be able to talk to you. We'll see you in
Oh, you're
Chicago.
the
Break
best.
legs tonight in Israel,
Thank you.
and Toda
Thank you, Todah Rabah.
Rabah.